I think I will start, Dr. Hafiz. Is that all right?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. So as I explained before, I'm basically a data scientist. By no means I would like to claim myself to be an epidemic expert or someone with a healthcare background. But in my life experience, I have worked for more than 8 years in healthcare software development industries. And many of my observations are coming from those experiences and from my academic research, which I pursued for University of Technology in Sydney for almost 7-8 years. So what I would like to speak today about is a few important numbers, 7 important numbers of COVID-19 in global scope and in your personal space. Then how data science can help to interpret certain things of COVID-19 pandemic issue. Then what can be possible quick use cases we can think of using machine learning, artificial intelligence, and automation for this particular health demand, which has exponentially increased due to a lot of patients being cured at healthcare centers. And finally, we will discuss about some key takeaways. So to start with, as I was looking last night, we were having almost 855,000 or more confirmed cases in the world. Among them, so far, 1,700 and 700 only recovered, more than 41,650 dead. It's been spread to 190 plus countries. It has a potential to make 25 million people to lose their jobs or some sort of salary deduction to happen. Then at the moment, it's expected that at least 1 trillion GDP would be lost for entire world. And then in the process, what has happened is a lot of people have started working virtually, and it has increased unprecedented demand for internet usage. And obviously, it's creating further issues like performance and hacking and security concerns. Another perspective to look at COVID from a data point of view is, what is your personal space and why you have to take care on certain things and keep yourself isolated or try to have a social distance? So research says that one sneeze can produce up to 40,000 droplets. And as we can see, sometimes the velocity of sneeze is so fast that you can sneeze up to 8 meters away from your body. Then one cough can create 1,000 to 2,000 droplets, and it can be spread up to 6 meters. Then your normal speech can produce up to 50 droplets every minute. Then in my personal life, based on my professional background, on an average, I have to shake at least 3 to 4 people's hand, which are unknown to me every day, or at least even if known, not within my family or my company close knit. Then my personal habit also says that I would touch my nose knowingly, unknowingly, at least 6 to 8 times in an hour. Then again, what I have observed when it comes to social distancing, we tend to distance ourselves minimally when it comes to picking up food or going to cafe or any ticketing queue. And then beyond that, there are certain health professionals or any other professionals who need to interact with human body very closely and touch other people. So we don't know, because we don't have any concrete data around that. So these are the basically 2 perspectives in terms of global and your personal numerical part to the COVID. Now, when it comes to innovation related with data science, essentially the journey should start with having some subject knowledge. Again, we don't need to be subject matter experts or doctor, but we need to have some level of understanding of the subject so that we can able to collaborate with subject matter experts. Then first quick use case many times starts by visualizing whatever data you have, whatever data subject matters would like to interpret in a very quick manner. So nowadays using Tableau or Power BI or any visualization tool, any ideas around that particular visualization activities is a good idea. Then you need to find out data from various sources. Nowadays data can be either coming through structured or unstructured from through APIs and websites, or it can be even static data sitting somewhere in a government department. And then based on that, you can use your machine learning or any computational algorithmic approach to predict certain parameters as asked by your subject matter expert, that what's going to happen in a certain dimension of this massive epidemic spread. So when it comes to body of knowledge, I won't dwell too much into what is this disease and what exactly the medical terminologies around, because I think we are most of us aware of it. But generally speaking, it is a novel kind of coronavirus. Coronavirus was always there, but this is a new one. And we don't have any vaccine or any medical answer to that. And that's why it's a major worry for the world. Then we do have to understand global, national, regional, and local statistics, that what exactly is happening at the world level, what is happening in your country, and how your particular zone or suburb is being affected, so that that will create an awareness about what sort of personal measures you need to take. We need to keep ourselves away from myths and rumors. For example, all around the world, everyone is stacking toilet tissues. Nobody's sure why. Then some publication was published a few months back, I think from China, that drinking hot raw tea would help to cure from COVID-19, but that was then taken off. So we have to basically keep ourselves away from those kind of myths and have to go with really, really authentic data. Then we have to understand what sort of healthcare facilities and their capacities around us, so that any reckless action from us, how it's going to affect the healthcare system in overall and even your personal life, that understanding would come. Then good idea to have how the general pandemic spread happens, so that you will keep yourself away from other people by social distancing or isolation. And then there are vaccine related efforts happening around the world. So good idea to keep a watch that what is happening and how far we are away, because that will give us a hope that we are not too far away and we'll definitely get over it. Now, when it comes to visualization efforts around the world, I think most of us have seen this Johns Hopkins University visualization. It's developed in Tableau. What exactly it does is it gives you a list of countries and it gives you also a map with spread of COVID-19 across the world. Apart from that, I as well tend to take references from World Health Organization. They have two visualizations. One is about mapping the COVID, and another is about mapping the in general health emergency around the world. Because there are certain countries who are facing certain other epidemies beyond COVID, and then a combination of those two diseases may be a deadly effect on their population. So understanding what is happening over there, you can use the World Health Organization dashboard. Then there are other dashboards. Worldmeter is excellent in terms of giving you tabular data. For any localized Australian information, you can use ESRI. And then Visual Capitalist as well has got interesting visualization in terms of how 100 cases onwards got increased in a particular country. So especially China, saturation curve it is showing, certain countries it is upwards trend, and so on. And then standard search engines including Bing and Google as well have introduced their own visualization. So among three most important, which I think are very good in terms of giving you a daily update. John Hopkins, as I said, gives you country-wide spread and a little bit drill down for countries like Australia and US and China, where you can go to state level and see what's happening in your state. World Health Organization, as I explained, two visualizations, one for COVID only, one for combined with any other disease. World Meter, again, tabular data distribution by demographics, because it's very important to have a look that which age group or which demographic is hit really hard. And based on that, certain measures in terms of policy making can be helped. Then it also gives you plots for fatality cases and many other parameters. So when it comes to data perspective, we thought of having at least four perspectives. One is what sort of business objectives and goals you have, what exactly you're trying to achieve, because looking at those global maps and global statistics and coming up with certain computational models and visualization, I think many people are already doing it, but for your particular scope of business, what exactly you're looking for. Then when it comes to epidemic management, you need to have data about local medical facilities, your demography in whatever area you're living in, and your business goal associated any attached parameters which will help you to proceed further. Then as we know, in the language of big data, data has got volume, velocity, and complexity. So in this particular case, data is mostly in available in either in many websites or either in many government repositories. It can be either structured, semi-structured, or it can be in spatial form like pictures and videos. And then last perspective is about time, because many agencies are receiving real-time data from field, and then that data is being updated. So what you are getting is near real-time information, and at the same time, many other details like demography or suburban profile, etc., you can definitely find from repositories of your local government. So going to the further detail of those perspectives. So for example, structured data will have either structured, lingual, or spatial. Then temporal perspective, real-time, historical, or dark. Dark means it is basically never used data and it can be handy in this particular situation. Then health sciences has got massive information around. So any electronic records or administrative or clinical trials, disease, and a lot of information around. The worry here is this data may or may not be easily available for research purpose, and you may have to take special permissions from authorities, or in some cases you may also have to buy it. Then last one is very important for a general public, because it's about demographic. So wherever you are staying, what sort of age group you have, what sort of gender, income group, ethnicity you have, what is the distribution of all those parameters in your population, then what sort of population density you are having, what sort of incoming tourist you are having, are they international, are they local, and how many public transport facilities you are having, public gatherings you are having. So all those parameters will develop a complex mathematical model to come up with a formula that how person-to-person transmission may happen. So reliable data sources for any further research or use case development. So I've come up with those many really good data sets. So mostly World Health Organization, John Hopkins University, and certain government authorities, they're giving very good data sets. Then if somebody is interested in clinical trials around vaccines, there is this Australian company called HealthMatch, and they can give you a real-time update about what's happening with clinical trials of COVID-19. When it comes to proposed data journey, Based on my experience, what I think is you will have to develop your problem context, and then you will have to identify related data sources. Having hundreds of data sources and using each and every piece of data is not going to help. You'll have to really identify what you are looking for and what data source is suitable for your needs. Then in that particular scope or that particular set of data, what sort of structure and attributes you can make out? Because at the end of the day, any further action, you will have to structure that data in a certain tabular form and save it in a database so that you can apply your any further automation and machine learning AI effort around that. Then since we are in lot of hurry, we are doing a lot of things in ad hoc manner, we tend to forget about governance and security measures. But I would say that is also a must thing, because this is the time when a lot of hackers would be waiting for, and you may lose out on certain things. Then you need to have data storage, some sort of data storage policy, and then based on that, finally, you can develop your analysis and report. So it's a long journey, but certain things can be easily automated, and you can create your use cases comparatively fast. Now, with recent experience for quick data acquisition from web, or in common terminology, web scraping, I have developed a couple of approaches, or I would say I have observed a couple of approaches. One can be you can use a robotic process automation tool where your user actions will be imitated by the robotic process automation software, and it will create a sequence of actions, and that will basically create a programming script which you can repetitively use for extracting data from websites. Or otherwise, if somebody is having expertise and is enthusiastic enough and quickly, something like Python programming library. So one second, I'll just have a look if somebody is.
No, Android has pictures. So
just give me one second. I will mute one of the participants. I think. Hi, can everyone hear me? Okay. Hello, Dr. Hafiz. Can everyone hear me?
Yes, it's good. So Anup, you can mute all the participants if there is a background noise.
Okay, I think they themselves muted, so I'll continue. So coming back to the data acquisition journey, especially when it comes to real-time web-based data, possibly using one of those two approaches will be a quicker one. Robotic process automation, I think in a day, for your particular small use case, you should be able to start extracting data, and you should be able to start using it for further visualization and other purposes. So when it comes to predicting pandemic spread, at the moment, combination of these two models, exponential and SIR. SIR means susceptible, infectious, and recovered. So that particular combination is in practice. So what it means basically is one person is going to spread it to multiple persons. In Australia, the number is expected between 2 to 3. And then next day, those 2.5 people would spread it to another 2.5 times, and so on. But then in the cycle, there are certain people who will be recovered and coming back to a susceptible pool again. So what it means basically is you have a mathematical model with some limited capability, which does average spread calculation on daily basis, but it does not give you distribution of that spread on the map for your particular geography or you know, around the world. It just basically does deterministic calculations to keep showing you how the spread is happening. But if you look at it from in general operational perspective, when it comes to any disease in human body, we do not operate by switching off brain of human being. We do the local anesthesia and then we proceed with any related operational activity. So in this particular case as well, since we do not have that sort of capacity with this mathematical model, our tendency is shut everything down, stop all businesses, and just wait till it goes away. So that's the limitation we are having here. So based on this background knowledge, I thought of coming up with potential use cases and case studies from a machine learning and AI perspective. So with my experience and my research knowledge, I can think of at least 6 quick use cases we can come up with. We can develop a pandemic spread model using machine learning. We can come up with a automation for a health request queuing system. We can come up with some sort of web-based platform for awareness purpose of society, where query against question kind of format will be used to make people aware about their health condition and what is happening around the world, rather than everyone start calling to local agencies and crowding their phone line. Then next is about reducing administrative burden by using software robots. So what beautiful capacity software robots offer is they do interfere or they do interact with healthcare management softwares or ERP softwares like SAP on your behalf, and can do your repetitive task like entering patient form or giving a certain sort of repetitive statistical data to any other third party. Then we do have dispensing and automated delivery robots in practice in certain areas. So that is also another area to explore on, because one of the most sensitive age group in this particular pandemic spread is senior age group, 80 plus, and many of them living in nursing homes, living isolated. For them, giving services through robots and maintaining social distance can be done. And then finally, use of IoT sensors for remote health monitoring for non-critical health conditions can reduce the burden on healthcare system and help us to develop more and more social distance and isolation practice. So possible model for predicting the current COVID crisis or any crisis in future. So what I'm proposing here is use of demographic, geographic, cultural, health and pandemic information, feed that to machine learning classifier, and based on that come up with a risk factor, whether high, medium or low. So this particular data is now available because in the journey of COVID last 3 to 4 months, many countries can make this sort of data available, which can be used to the countries which are a little bit late in the journey or which are trying to do some research around and develop some computational model to develop their policies. Then next step would be this risk factor along with same data can be fed to some decision classification system to think about whether a particular zone or suburb is really high risk and or low risk, or it really needs full or partial blockade or shutdown. Because shutting down everything and stopping entire economic activity is not helping anyone. But having a measured approach using some machine learning algorithms would possibly allow us to take a measured approach and help us to keep economy going, at the same time help us to reduce pandemic spread. So I have given a list of possible features for each and every category. there may be more, and we can possibly develop this model further with any more feature categories as well. Then second use case is about using cognitive automation, where sensory signals coming through messages, say telephone or chatbot, or through users' interaction with their telephone applications, can be converted into a query. Then that query will be sent to some automated process controlled by a software robot, which will interpret that query, and in return it will start guiding that query by asking certain questions. And then with some conversation, it will make out that this query is having certain level of priority and needs certain level of data recording or creating a patient queue or patient case. And then that all task can be done through software robot, which is obviously be monitored by one of admin staff occasionally, because in today's world, all these tasks mostly are done by human or by hospital or healthcare staff. So if you can reduce that administrative burden here, then what happens is the same person can allocate his time for more and more meaningful activities in healthcare related space. And then you will need some sort of knowledge update happening from doctors and specialists to develop your policy around ticketing and queuing system, because criticality of health is something always updated by local authorities like Medicare and all, and that something has to be accommodated in your software system. So this can be a beautiful use case where you can combine certain AI features along with human interaction and give an automated solution. So, but it doesn't come easily. It has got three or four major areas to work on. One is automating administrative activities. Second one is automating reception activities, which can be either voice or chatbots. Then next one is managing query, again through voice or chatbots. And last one is about user interaction. So around that, recently we have developed one little automation use case for a particular company affected by COVID crisis. So what they were having was they were having two staff working on data entry and related admin activities, and they were taking almost 2 weeks for extracting data available on a website on first day of the month. Now in the process, what was happening was there were a lot of inaccuracies, mistyping, spelling mistakes. Also obviously it was incurring cost, then it was creating delay of 2 weeks. So what we did was we created a robotic automation script using this Automation Anywhere software tool and reduced that 2 weeks delay time to up to 6 hours. So on a day one, if you run the software bot, it will extract all that data, store it in your data storage, and then you can reuse that data for your further business activities. What it means is, a particular client, if you're going to contact them after 2 weeks as per your queue, you would contact them on second day itself. So what it did basically, it obviously saved good amount of money for a year for that particular business. It also created more space for those staff to do more meaningful activities rather than doing repetitively boring same stuff, and they were happy with it. And we are now working on adding some cognitive abilities and enhance this automation so that more automation for repetitive and boring tasks will help them to develop their business model in this need of time. Second use case category is about remote healthcare monitoring. So I think IoT sensors used for monitoring healthcare through wearable sensing is very popular. Again, if you are looking for non-critical kind of health monitoring in today's time, what will happen is it will decrease the queue towards healthcare facilities, and people will be able to monitor certain little healthcare issues at home, and possibly something like Telstra's virtual health monitoring kind of solution will be able to give them service at home. So again, two advantages here is it will reduce burden on the current healthcare system, and it will also help to stay themselves in isolation mode. So there are quite a few use cases, very specific use cases around it. In the past, I have worked for a company which used IoT sensor for monitoring urination in nappies, especially for elderly people. So it's case by case, but certain low priority and low criticality use cases can definitely accommodated now. And you can also think about using non-intrusive technologies like wireless sensors. And then last one is about using physical robots for dispensing and serving purpose. So I happen to work for a company which was in space of pharmacy software development, and I have seen dispensing robots being deployed for dispensing scripts. But the current business process is about submitting script to pharmacist or a pharmacy technician, and then they will feed that particular script to dispensing robot, and then it will give back the medication. There will be some interaction happening between patient and pharmacy staff. But this entire chain altogether can be replaced with next level of automation, where user can use either their telephone app, mobile phone app, or some kiosk, and scan their electronic script, and then software robot would dispense them with some advice that, are you after a generic, are you after a original drug, or do you need any other kind of advice from pharmacist? What happens in this case is, say out of 10 cases, even if 6 to 7 cases people stop going directly to pharmacy staff, then they can optimize their time for better healthcare related activities. Many more use cases, but looking at demand of the time and looking at available expertise, I've touched the base on those three particular areas, but absolutely a lot can be done in this need of time, and sky's the limit. Major takeaways out of this presentation are, yes, data is a oil which is very valuable to everyone, but since you are in hurry, it doesn't mean that you're not going to refine and validate it, or you're not going to use it in unsecured manner. You'll have to put security measures, you'll have to refine it, and you'll have to validate it. You'll have to validate with 2 or 3 different sources that whatever data you are getting in real-time sense, it is a correct data. Then you can use free trial versions for 1 to 3 months and try out certain use cases, and especially what will happen in this particular need of time, you will be able to develop some prototypes and serve to the end user, and then once the need of time is over, you can also think about what else you can do and make it a production fit product. Now we are in the era of low coding, no coding, or off the shelf coding templates, where rapid prototyping development is very easy. So as an example, using some sort of automation software like robotic process automation, it's something child's play. So anyone having some technical background but not inclined to code can develop their products, and they can easily start serving to the current pandemic issues. Then next is about what we are into now. We are doing a lot in terms of remoting, virtualization, and automation. And again, when it comes to healthcare perspective, I think virtualization and automation definitely will help to reduce burden on healthcare facilities and keep people isolated to reduce the pandemic spread. And finally, I would like to say rumors, panic, and cost-cutting measures, they do spread much faster than any disease. So please refer to genuine data. Don't panic, but definitely refer to the data and take essential measures. This is about my company, Cloud Tech Info. I work here. So we are in helping people for the digital transformation journey. I'm not an enterprise architect, but my colleague Sunil will be the best person to explain the entire journey. But in general, our goal is to optimize your resources and give you smart solutions. So finally, I would like to open for questions. And if anything, please email me on my email address, anoop.kale@cloudtechinfo.com. Thank you.
Thank you, Anoop. It was a great presentation. If anyone has questions, they can unmute their microphones or they can type in the chat window. So Anoop will be more than happy to answer that. So Anoop,
it's a great knowledge. Great knowledge. Anoop has given a very nice information here. We're very happy to listen all these things.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So Anoop, I got one quick question.
Sure.
You mentioned about controlled lockdown. So I'm just wondering what can be done, you know, because we cannot lock down everything. We need to have a mechanism based on the data, you know, where we can see who is fit for going out based on vital sign monitoring and other data information. So what approach do you suggest, you know, to implement such controlled movement solution where you don't have a full lockdown?
Yep. See, I would like to go back to one of my slides. Just give me 1 second. That machine learning model I'm working on. So give me 1 sec. Yeah. So what we need to do is basically we need to use a combination of static and dynamic data. So static data means each and every local council will have demographic data. Each and every local council will have data related with businesses, industries, and all. So that level of information, if you can extract to find out that particular zone, how much it is interacting with outside world. And then based on that, you can always come up with risk factor. Because as an example, if we look in Sydney metropolitan, I can imagine something like Blue Mountains. On the surface, it would look very, very innocent, isolated area. But then it does receive a lot of international tourists. So in that case, definitely you will have to stop international tourism going there. But then in a limited way, possibly they can function. Or there are certain suburbs which are having plenty of nursing homes and aged care houses. Again, isolation is must there. So we'll have to model all the information at possibly council level and come up with risk factor. And then once you have risk factor, you propose limited blockade. And then within that shell, you can start operating. That's something I can think of.
Yeah, that's really great. Any other questions from the audience, please?
Yeah, I've got, I have some concerns about this specific virus in particular, because it has a very high R0, up to 6, and we've seen evidence of that in many countries. It's aerosolized. Anything from 10 to 30% of the infected patients can be asymptomatically shedding the virus and infecting, which makes detection very hard, especially in community spread. And there's been one example where an asymptomatic individual was continuously shedding high viral loads for 49 days, no symptoms.
Yep.
So this one is quite unique.
Yep. So, I mean, that's why we have to have a look at the data. I mean, I'm not proposing anything in a concrete way, but I'm proposing that look at the data, try to model it, and see what are the most common observations. Because at the moment, what is happening is immensity of the problem has created proportional immensity in terms of available data, and then processing that data manually is not possible. So using some level of automation to fetch that data and feed that data into machine learning models to come up with at least some risk factors or observation or isolation factors, then that can be a start to work with. And I'm pretty sure, I mean, whoever has worked in healthcare industry, we never start with very optimistic approach. We always start with worst possible case scenario, and the that's how possibly I would think about it.
Any other questions from the audience, please? Anup, I got a quick question. You mentioned about telehealth and vital sign monitoring. So what do you recommend are the best possible commercially available apps which can be used for continuous vital sign monitoring in this COVID-19 period?
So I'll have to have a look on that part, but so we're talking about remote health monitoring, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So there is a list of recent top 11 companies I'm having, and I've done some product analysis on that. So possibly I can email that to you. But again, as I was saying to the previous questioner, in this current scenario, I would start with a very safe approach, where would start with non-critical observations being served through virtual health, and then we'll take it from there. Because when it comes to any healthcare or related application, unless it is a medical device grade and very well proven, trying in this particular time junction will be very risky. But I'll send that information to you.
Sure. Thank you, Anup. Any other questions from the audience, please?
Hi, Anup. It was a wonderful presentation, mate. Just had a question. There are a lot of organizations at this stage possibly started to think about their employee health and perspective. So it could be, imagine it could be an operation, it could be a mine site, it could be a manufacturing operation. Some of these critical essential sort of manufacturing plant that are still working, and they want to try and prevent their staff or their employees and possibly geofence, you know, if you detect a case within that point of time. So is there a way this prototype or, you know, the approach that you've suggested could be geofence, could be uplifted, where we actually have a bit of a visual as well of who the people are, who employs, and obviously start tracking their health and then in general their movement. And I'll put a caveat, legal and other considerations and privacy considerations still needs to be sorted, but from technology perspective, could that be used?
Yeah, I think use of medical grade wearable devices, that's the safest way I can think of. So whichever staff is working on site for any inevitable reasons, they can use medical grade wearable sensors, and that data possibly in a secured manner being monitored by any of the healthcare practitioner or any of the consultants for that particular organization, that would definitely help out. Because it has to be medical grade, that's my understanding is. Because I'm wearing a Fitbit and many people are wearing many other wearable devices. But you have to have medical grade, that's the thing. So medical grade IoT device with some consultation from a healthcare professional, that can be one way.
Anup,
thank you.
I've got
one question here.
Sure.
Yeah. See, somebody is there on the line. Sorry.
That's right. Who would like to go first?
Okay. I'll say, Anup, the model what you suggested or what you explained, if organizations or government agencies, if they have followed your method or your approach, might be this pandemic could have been, the effect could have been minimized. So what's your thoughts?
I think I've seen your presentation as well. And one thing you were stressing about, we are living in connected world. Now, when it comes to living in connected world, we live for our economic compulsions in a connected world. But then that also means that we should start sharing certain healthcare related information, certain demographic information. Mostly UNESCO and those global agencies will have certain data, but this kind of healthcare data as well, in a secured manner, if it is shared with UNESCO or United Nations or World Health Organization, then what happens is you can have a continuously operating computational model which will keep on looking for potential risks, health risk or pandemic spread risks. So that's something I can think of. But for that, a lot of politics has to go away, and a lot of countries will have to cooperate with each other, especially when it comes to this sort of pandemic spread. Earlier, the availability of information, it will be more good for that particular country and all other countries as well. It's not a criticism, but it's more of basically having those kind of mechanisms in place along with technology will help, because technology itself is a blind thing. It needs to be fed with a proper data, and that data will only come with the consent of a particular authority or a particular person or user.
Thanks, sir. So mainly privacy and transparency. Thanks.
Yeah, it has to be done in secured manner with each other's consent, but at the same time, it's a must thing. We need to have, I think Dr. Hafiz has posted once about having war rooms kind of arrangement around the world. And I think that is the need of time now, because it's happening very continuously, and not every time we can think of shutting down everything and, you know, stopping all businesses.
Thank you.
Welcome.
So Anup, one of the things that we've obviously seen is the World Health Organization have been critical that not enough countries are testing.
Yeah.
A lot of countries are complaining about the accuracy and availability of tests and have been artificially constraining who they test, only high-risk categories.
Yep.
Why have we yet to see any robotic environmental testing instead of just people testing? So we have robots that will sweep through a train station or sweep through an office or test through a air conditioning system and look for potential viral RNA, and then at least you know when environments have been exposed to an infected individual and can then start to zero down on who the infected individuals are. Why is that lacking?
I think having robots, mobile robots, is a possibility, but attaching proper instrumentation to create test setup is the problem, because it's a novel one kind of thing, and developing any kind of instrumentation and in this mass and this scale is the issue, and that's why it may not have happened. But I think in future, coming up with this sort of scenario where people walk in to the test booth and do their own tests, that can be one way to look at it. Then what happens is you don't need to have so many healthcare staff, and you can do your test in a limited sense on your own. Have I answered? Sorry.
No, because that assumes that you have enough tests to test every person who wants to be tested, and we've proven that's not the case.
Yeah, yeah.
So the recommendation was instead to test environments for environmental exposure, right, in addition to doing high-risk people testing to try and, understand where it is.
No, but in this particular test, in this particular case, I think a couple of days back only, World Health Organization has declared that it's not an airborne thing. It's about droplets. And now source of droplets is a human being. And in some cases, that droplet being attached to some object, possibly that can be tried. But then that's an immense scope to test even using a robot, because each and every robot will need to have instrumentation to look at object through machine vision and try to scan through and all. And not each and every robot will function equivalent to human eyes. That's the limitation, basically. So testing environment, in confined environment, known parameters possible, but we are dealing with a lot of unknowns here.
Yeah, the World Health Organization have been misleading on that one. There is no proven evidence that it is not airborne, and there is contradictory evidence that indicates it may be airborne. And so they should be using the precautionary principle, and their advice is wrong.
Yeah, but that's what I came across, because again, I am not a doctor, I'm a data scientist. So I would have to depend on the subject matter experts, and I'll have to make a call from there. I'm serving to their purpose, more of.
Okay, Anup, thank you very much. I think we can take further questions offline.
Yeah,
and
sure.
If you have any queries, you can email to Anup, and
please email me.
Take it offline.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for listening. Thanks for opportunity, so, Dr. Hafiz.
Yes, thank you. I think now I would like to invite our next speaker, Mr. Maroon. He is a digital transformation director at Cognizant in Dubai. He will be talking about the role of connectivity and digital opportunities in the COVID-19 era. So over to you, Maroon.
Hello, everyone. How are you doing? Can you see my screen?
Yes. We can see your video.
Okay, excellent. Just a second to start my screen. And
we'll share.
Okay, looking for share.
It's on the top or the bottom?
Exit full screen and share screen. Okay.
Yeah, we can see your screen now.
Okay, excellent. Just one more second to do something.